On behalf of Surajya, I'd like to welcome our guest today, Rajiv Chandrasekhar. We might have other guests joining you also a little later, but for the time being, we will talk with Rajiv, which will be a one-on-one discussion. We will have time for audience questions. The focus of today's discussion and talk is about the One Nation, One Poll, which the Prime Minister has strongly advocated. He's been saying it for a while. And just a few weeks back and a few days back, he again mentioned it. You need a discussion on it. So we should start the discussion on that. So, Rajiv, one thing, the PM has made the case, but many are not convinced. So what is the best argument for what the PM advocates? Why do you think having all polls with the center, state, and local bodies all together at around the same time, what is the best argument in favor of it?
Look, Jagi, you know that we are at a time when we are talking about reforms and we are talking about a new vision for a new India. We talk about Atmanirbhar Bharat, and usually the conversation is around reforms in the economy or reforms in certain other segments of aspects that impact people's lives. But if you look at elections and if you look at democracy, and I'll just start by giving you an anecdote, Jagi, that in the late 80s, India and China were about the same level of economic development, if you want to call it that, the West vis-a-vis the West. In the late 80s, the US stepped up and started supporting China. And it was the result of the Cold War. US did not like Russia, and Russia did not like China. So the US enemy is my friend. And I have recently studied documents about the enormity of the support and technology and capital that the US gave China. The irony is, I want to use this as a to point out the irony, that the world's biggest democracy or the most powerful democracy was ending up creating a monster, which is a communist monster, China. Whereas an Indian country, which is the world's largest democracy, sat around on the sidelines being ignored by the US because they thought we were socialist and China was a free market. And in a lot of ways, this has to do with the core of the, people say democracy, democracy is bad, democracy is noisy, democracy is chaotic. And I think this leads to this point today that Prime Minister Modi has started a conversation on is how do we improve the political side of our democratic system? While we have spoken for since 1990 about economic reforms and governance reforms, what is it that we need to do about political reforms? And the biggest beneficiary of these political reforms, Jagi, is you, me, and every other common citizen. It is our taxpayer money. And I say I because I am a citizen before I'm a politician. It is our capital at work, our taxpayer at work that is funding this whole political establishment. So if you just start with the construct that as citizens, how do we make our political system more reformed, more responsive, more disciplined, and more accountable? And you pose that question, one of the first answers you'll come up with is one nation, one election. Fewer elections, more accountability, make an elected representative serve his entire term, make him accountable for his entire term. All of this equals one nation, one election. Now, that is one aspect, which is political reform. The other dividend that comes out of this, which is as important, is the economic dividend. Because the simple cost of holding elections and the economic loss caused by a nation or a state or a panchayat or a village or a town coming to standstill for 4 months of that election process is if there is real naya paisa rupee loss that is ascribable to that process. So all in all, in my opinion, there are two real dividends. One is the entire political reform and accountability dividend, and the second is the economic dividend.
How do you answer one criticism that basically we are a federal country and the issues at the center, at the state, and the local body level are not the same? At local bodies, you may want to talk about garbage or parking fees or whatever. And at the state level, you want to talk about broader things like agriculture, labor reform, and at center, you want to talk about defense and say broader issues or macroeconomics and things. Right. So if you mix it all up in one poll, won't there be a confusing signal to the voter where you end up voting on one issue, whereas my issue in Bengaluru is different from your issue in, say, Patna, or for that matter, in Delhi?
No, I completely agree with you. And I think you're absolutely right that the issues in the Bangalore municipal elections are different from the Karnataka state elections, are different from the national elections. But that is not a contradiction to one nation, one election. And the reason why it's not a contradiction, despite the canards and the fiction being spread by certain regional party interests who have an interest in keeping this status quo alive, is that the voters of India today clearly discriminate and understand between what is what election, what leader, for what context are they voting for. Many elections are held where, for example, we had elections in Andhra Pradesh that was coterminous with the national elections. The electorate there voted for a different chief minister, they elected for a different prime minister. So this notion that 70 years on, and you know, as an independent country and this vibrant democracy, that somehow the electorate, which is common citizens, don't understand the difference is really patronizing and is arrogant. And not only patronizing and arrogant, it is also self-serving to some vested interests who want to keep this chaotic instability that is represented by the system alive. So I don't think so. I think the voter today in Bengaluru knows very clearly when he's voting for roads and garbage, when he's voting for Karnataka government, and when he's voting for the prime minister of this nation. So there's absolute clarity in my mind to a large extent. Of course, there will always be pockets where electorates are confused, but that is going to be the case any which way.
Right. So a related argument which needs explanation is, I think the regional parties are worried that when you have somebody as popular as Mr. Narendra Modi at the top, the chance of a bandwagon effect, where let's say you like the guy at the center, so there will be a Modi effect in state and a Modi effect in the municipal thing. Do you think, I mean, it's just a variant of the same argument. Do you think it works like that?
No, it doesn't work like that. And you can see that, Jaggi. You can see that in Delhi. You've seen that in Jharkhand. The BJP, the party to whom I belong and whom I represent, is a party that will obviously, we'll put our leader, the best leader forward and make a strong effort in winning the electoral support. But the voters are very clear in their mind. If they see that they prefer a certain leader, that happens to be from a different party in the state, and they prefer a different leader for the center, they are already doing it. Yes. So the concern that a national once in 5 year election process somehow diminishes the opportunity or diminishes the competitiveness of a regional party, in my opinion, is not based on any fact.
Right. One thing, actually, your last point actually leads me to the practical aspects of these things. One is, one question that people ask is, let's say you elected a government at whichever level, and say 15 days or a few months after the election, the government falls because of internal differences, right? Now, do you wait 5 years for, or do you have 5 years of governor rule, or do you have some other option, or do you go, since you can't have an election again after 6 months, how do you get over this this practical issue?
No, and I think that is the debate that we need. I think clearly that there are constitutional changes that have to be made. There have been changes. This debate has gone on for a few months, and learned experts on this have said the People's Act have to be amended, etc. But the basic point, Jaggi, is this: that when a legislature is elected for 5 years, they must sit in the legislature and discharge their duty for 5 years.
Right.
Now, if they form a government in the first month based on a certain combination of legislators, and they choose after 2 months to unravel that, it is for that legislature to work together to find an alternate government. but not to put the bill on the top of the citizens and say, no, we like to go back to elections and you pay the bills. That's the point I'm making. I'm making the point that when I said the first dividend is that political reform dividend, it is necessary for us to bring in the political class, and I am a political class, the discipline and the accountability that once you get go out there and get an expensive taxpayer paid mandate from a lot of people who come out and vote, exercise their democratic vote, it is your job to make sure for 5 years you give development. There is a reciprocal obligation on the part of the people who stand for elections. Just like there is an obligation on the part of people who go out and vote for good, there's an obligation to vote for good people. The reciprocal obligation on the part of those who get elected is, we are going to go there and work hard for 5 years for the development of our constituency, development of our state, development of our municipality. Oh, and by the way, if the leader who formed the government falls because he loses confidence, there has to be a process by which a new leader is elected, but the legislature continues for his entire term.
Right.
So that is the basic principle here, Jaggi.
Correct. Some people, especially I think one of your party colleagues, Mr. Baijayan Panda, has suggested that maybe rather than one nation, one poll, maybe one nation, two polls. That is, you have two polls conducted in a five-year period. So whenever there is a problem in something, it can happen after 2.5 years. So there is not significant disruption, and yet you do not have continued instability for, say, suppose you have elected a bunch of guys who simply can't work with each other and you need a fresh mandate. So at least you can wait within...
I would argue that I think we should explore constitutionally what is possible. But whether it is an all-party setup, maybe let us assume that there is no majority government that is possible. And I'm just tossing ideas at you. I'm not a constitutional expert. But maybe then there is a coalition of all parties that governs the state for the rest of the term of the legislature.
Yes.
Or there is some other alternate mechanism where there is a governor aided by the all the parties in the legislature.
Yeah.
So the one nation, one poll does not need to be diluted unless somebody comes back with a material finding that it is not doable. One nation, two elections is not solving the problem because, like I said, it is about fundamentally not just about cost and disruption. It is also about making the political class understand that they are being sent to the legislature to govern and do their job for 5 years.
Correct. No, I completely agree that if you're going to have elections coming every 6 months, that is impossible for any government or any legislature to function for 5 years. So you're actually thinking a few months at a time rather than 5 years at a time in order to do what you have to do.
Yeah, and I'll add one more point, Jaggi. Just think about it, where we are as a nation today. We have, after GST, we have become one nation, one market.
Correct.
Now imagine in the pre-GST era, and I'm giving you it's a side example, but it's an important example, demonstrative example.
Right.
If there was elections in Karnataka, it was the Karnataka economy that got impaired for 4 months, 5 months.
Correct. Correct.
Okay. And the rest of the country sort of moved on without that much of an impact, excepting for trans-border movement of goods and products. Now we are creating actively one nation, one market. So the producer in Karnataka has access to the consumer in Orissa, and the producer in Orissa has access to the consumer in Karnataka. Assume for a minute, 4 months Karnataka goes for a six because elections have come up three times in 2 years.
Right.
It disrupts this whole one nation, one market, because a certain part of the market has been put on cold storage for 4 months.
That's right.
So I think when we now think of the overall economic architecture, we think of rising aspirations of our people and rising expectations of our citizens from our politicians, the arrow points in one direction, which is that we've got to create some political reforms in the electoral process.
Right. Do you see any logistical issues from the election commission point of view of holding so many, meaning like say in the same constituency, you're holding three sets of elections, right? Center, state and local body. Is there a...
I think my background, I believe in technology.
That's right.
I think if we put a challenge in front of the people of this country, we will find solutions.
Right.
I think we to start creating these artificial sort of fears that we can't do this. If we are sending rockets to the moon, we can conduct elections for three candidates simultaneously.
That's right.
Yeah, so right. I don't think that's not even the realm of my issues that I would be worried about.
Yeah, the other thing, related thing, not necessarily only about one nation, one poll. Do you think a parallel governance reform that needs is probably a shift to a presidential system, where there is a continuity regardless of whether legislators work together or not?
I'll tell you my frank view on this presidential versus prime minister parliamentary system discussion.
Right.
And I don't want to go too much off topic. I think that first of all, it's an acceptance somehow that our system, parliamentary system, doesn't work. And I'm not convinced about that. I think this is what the message from the prime minister also is, that we can make our system work much better than what it is doing today. We can give back to the people of this country a lot more than they are usually used to by a hardworking government in Delhi, but also with some political reforms that make the entire political class aligned to a certain set of expectations from the people who vote for them. So right. I don't think we should walk away from the parliamentary system, and this discussion of presidential versus parliamentary system sometimes distracts from what we ought to do, which is to fix the problems that we have in our system.
Right.
Moving to presidential system requires too many legislative changes, and it is not something that is going to be even remotely trivial to bring into play.
But one thing, even to a shift to one nation, one poll, won't it require substantial constitutional amendments?
Oh, yes, of course. I think that is why I think this is a good thing. I think if more and more people understand the political and the economic dividends from this, and these are not small dividends. These are significant dividends. And we are talking $8-10 billion of savings over a 3-year period. And over a 5-year period, that can be, we are talking $10-15 billion.
Right.
That is not a small amount of money. And think of how many hospitals, how many roads, how many schools we can build with that. So there is a real economic dividend. And like I said, the other very important thing that we should never take our eyes off is the political dividend of getting a new class, a new awareness amongst politicians, that they must serve for 5 years, and their job it is to serve for 5 years.
Do you see, assuming, let's say, we have crossed the hurdle of, getting the constitutional or legal changes required, do you see any short-term transitional problem? Because today, different state, center, municipal have different timelines in terms of where their term ends.
So some fellow
will have to be truncated, some faces will have to be elongated.
I think those are, in my opinion, the easier problems to solve. Once the people of India, there is an overwhelming consensus that this is a good thing for the country, this is a good thing for the people, the other solutions will happen. Currently the mission in front of the country and all of us is to create awareness and a consensus that this is the political reform that we want. Not for any political party or not for any political leader, but we want for ourselves as citizens. And if we achieve that, then I think the other problems are easily solved, not that difficult.
Right. So you talk to MPs and politicians across party lines at a personal level, no matter what your party position. So what do you think is the real sticking point for the opposition to oppose this basic governance reform idea?
No, I think today, as I was prepping for this, I was just Googling some of the quotes from people in the past.
Yeah.
Most of the quotes are, it is difficult, constitutional amendments are required. So that is one category of quotes.
Yeah, those are practical things. Yeah.
All reforms are difficult. As you know, you can see from the response to most reforms, they are all difficult.
Yeah.
And the Prime Minister Modi has not made it. He doesn't believe that there is only an easy reform. He takes on difficult reforms as well. So that is a separate issue. The second bucket of concerns or complainers or people who are worried are the so-called regional parties, Jaggi, as you correctly pointed out. And they are somehow concerned that this gives them, this in a sense reduces their political influence or the ability for them to campaign and politically reach out to their electorate, which I think is more paranoia than real based on anything real.
Right. No, how do you think this will impact the current federal structure or federalism in general, which everybody likes talking about?
No, it's absolutely no relation to it at all. You know that for many years after independence, we had simultaneous elections. It is not, and there was no discussion of federal structure or dilution of federal structure. The federal structure, the definition of a federal structure is that the states have their rights vis-a-vis their economy and their budgets and so on and so forth. The federal structure does not mean that the states have the right to decide when their elections are held. That is still by the National Central Election Commission.
Right.
So this is not an issue to do with the federal structure at all. This is, like I said to you, the only concern seems to be coming from some of the minor regional parties who believe, in my opinion, humbly, respectfully, mistakenly, that this somehow compromises their electoral chances, which frankly, as you've seen in Andhra, you've seen
Odisha. Yeah, correct. No, I think even all the so-called national parties like Congress have opposed it. So of course, whether Congress, which is reduced to a regional party, is a national
Congress,
party.
And Jaggi, Congress today, anything that the BJP proposes, the Congress just default switches into opposition mode.
Right. Okay. So, one thing, don't you think this governance reforms needs to go with greater look at the decentralization of power in general? Because a lot of people feel that things are a little too centralized in Delhi or in a state capital, like say cities, for example, don't seem to have mayors with real power. I mean, they're there to do some ribbon cutting and some inaugurations.
I think this is a separate, we can have a separate conference on this, on the 74th Amendment and municipal governance, that do we need directly elected mayors instead of some urban development minister holding charge of it and having nobody accountable for the fate of a city, the growth of a city, which may be why most of our cities today, after 70 years of independence, have become decrepit and overgrown and chaotic. So I think that is a separate issue from this. I think there are many reforms required in Atmanirbhar Bharat. The New India vision is a vision that is a dramatic departure in many ways from the previous way. And we can go into chapter and verse about it, whether it's economy, whether it is governance, whether it's political. We need a lot of reforms. The One Nation, One Election is a specific political reform idea in whose time has come. The electorate in India is mature enough to now start discriminating between state elections, municipal elections, panchayat, local body elections, and the national election. And I think this is a reform whose time has come. I strongly believe it, and it has significant real dividends for the citizen of India.
Yeah, I think some countries already have that. I'm told that countries like Sweden or South Africa already have that. Germany has a system where the legislator does not get dismissed in the middle of the term. They have to form a government whether they like it or not. They have to find a way to do so. I mean, if you don't think like that, I think
you can't move a no confidence motion unless you have an alternate confidence
that's
motion.
That's right. Correct. So
those are the reforms that will have to be accompanied with this, which is that you can't just suddenly pull down a government. You can only pull down a government if you have an alternate government, which goes back to this concept of saying, as a legislator, your job is to serve for 5 years, not to create an election every 2.5 years.
That's right. Does that mean you will also have to change that basic anti-defection law? Currently, what happens is, if you want to form an alternative government, say if one government falls, and if new government does not have the numbers, unless and until you break some other party or somehow you get numbers from somewhere, so that you need changes in that law as well, right?
No, I think I read a quote from a former chief election commissioner whose name I forget.
Rishi.
Who said that there are a number of laws that need to be examined. While this is a welcome political reform, he laid out a series of acts that need to be looked into and amended. RP Act is one.
Yeah.
The anti-defection law is one. So I think if you start with the fact that this is an objective that we want as a nation.
Right.
I was saying, Jaggi, that I don't think just saying one nation, one election is enough. I think if we come to a consensus that that's what we want, there will be a number of downstream acts and legislation that will have to be amended, enacted, et cetera, et cetera. So that is understood.
Right. The other thing is, do you really foresee a significant fall in party election expenditures at all levels of government, or do you think that it will go up? Because I think now you have to try and win three different elections at the same time.
Huh? No, I think there is an need for election campaign financing reform in any case.
Yeah.
But this will, to a large extent, reduce the cost of elections.
Right.
I mean, just simple common sense mathematics tells you, if you do just one election every 5 years, the money that you will spend as a party or as a candidate will be less. That's just common sense mathematics. If you accompany this with campaign funding reforms, that will further bring it down.
Right. And how do you see? If you were plotting a strategy where you need to have discussions with the opposition and multiple and this thing, do you think it is achievable in the next three and a half years that this government will be in power?
No, I think it's very achievable. I think anything is achievable if the people of India put their mind to it. Look, I think, Jaggi, just to be honest, 20, 25 years ago, I would not have thought when I came into India in the mid 90s, I didn't think I would be seeing governance and a polity where we are talking about reforms, where we are talking about cracking down on crony capitalism, all of that. It was never, I didn't think it was in the realm of possibility.
Right.
So I think a lot of things that we don't believe are possible can be possible if there is a critical mass of public support for the idea. And that is something we are seeing across the board, whether it is the cleaning up of the financial system, whether it is IBC, whether, GST, all kinds of reforms that we have seen have come because people have decided that that is what we want. So I think the challenge here today is to make the voter and the Indian citizen understand how much value there is to him or her and their families if there is one nation, one election, and all of the economic and political dividends that come out of that.
Right.
The moment the people get behind it, then, I think it becomes easier for everybody.
The way I see it is what people are probably coming to a view is that they see that a fractured kind of mandate is not of any use to them.
Agreed.
In fact, that is what they have learned over the last 10, 15 years.
Right.
Both especially in the UPA period, where I think there was practically no reform. You had all parties and each party was running one ministry or two ministries rather than the government running itself totally.
Just to support you on the point, I have done a detailed study from the late 80s, mid 80s to 2019 about the correlation of the economy and economic indicators to the stability of the national government.
Yeah.
And the relationship is inverse.
Uh-huh.
The relationship is not inverse. The relationship is direct. The stronger the central government, the better the economic growth.
Okay.
And the weaker and the more fractured the mandate at the center, the weaker the economic performance, governance, all of the performance. There is a direct correlation. And, one of these days we should do that. We should have a discussion on that.
Absolutely.
But
people have been saying the opposite.
I've got data, facts, all of that from the mid.
Largely because I think in the first 3-4 years of UPA there was high growth. So they're saying, but the coalition, that is the one of our peak times in 2003 to 2008, had very high growth. relatively. And I suppose because the world was growing, nothing to do with what you did.
The answer to that is very simple. The 2004 to 2008 growth was a Vajpayee dividend.
Yes,
it
correct.
Was what the government.
In fact, it started in 2003.
Of course, exactly.
Yeah. It's the takeoff started in 2003-04 and it continued.
So it was the momentum that carried them through 2008 till they took the hammer to it and demolished it.
Yeah, no, they didn't do reform, so it couldn't be sustained. So that is the problem. Yeah, I agree. But anyway, so I think this discussion would be worth having if we see that there are stronger governments.
I've absolutely done research on it and I'm prepared to stick my neck out and present the facts to you.
I think we should publish it in Swarajya too. Okay, so I'll ask you one or two concluding questions and we will ask audience if they have any questions.
Sure.
Right. So my point is how do you see, I think given the fact, I'm asking a politically loaded question, given the fact that most political parties are scared of the popularity of Mr. Modi, do you see those guys agreeing to anything he says, even assuming he says, I come with an open mind, you give me better suggestions, I'll do it. You see that happening. I think most of the opposition, for opposition's sake, is coming because they fear the popularity of this man.
Yeah, no, and therefore this conversation is not between Prime Minister Modi and any political party. This conversation that we have started today as the BJP is a conversation between the Prime Minister's idea and the people of India.
Right.
This may or may not benefit political parties or political dynasties or political families, but it clearly benefits the voter for whom all of us are supposed to be working for.
Right. Right.
So that is why this conversation is between us and the voter. And if the voter of India decides that they want A, B, C, you can be a dynasty that is 70 years old, or you could be a family that is made a lot of money in some regional politics. But if the voter says, I want this because I can see the benefit in terms of roads, schools, hospitals, they will vote for the people who give them this.
Right. To be a devil's advocate, what if I have the opposite argument that people may think that there is a great benefit in having an election every year because then everybody, this year Congress will promise me a free D, next year in a local election, BJP may promise one in a third. Here. Some other regional party may promise to give me a free vote. Somebody will give me a free laptop. So from a purely voter bribery point of view, it suits my, if you are totally amoral, it suits me to have an election every year.
And that is precisely what I think is the trend is going against that, Jagi.
Okay.
If you see that there is a, let's say 2014 and 2019 represent elections, which are, in my, they are significant milestones in the evolution of our democracy.
Right.
That they have voted with their head, they have voted with their heart, they have voted trust, they have voted on competence, they have voted on governance, credibility, and all of those things that are really fundamental to healthy democracy. So I am not saying that, inducements will go away or people trying to, but we saw that in 2019, a political party said, I will give you this amount of money, I will give you nyaya, I will give you that. And the people still rejected them.
Right.
So everybody today in India realizes that their prosperity that they look forward to is medium to long-term prosperity. They don't want just a handout, but they want a certainty that their children and subsequent generations can look to a life where they can, using their capabilities, build a better life for themselves, a prosperous life. So that is the new India. That is the Atmanirbhar Bharat narrative.
Yeah.
It is not about comparative freebies or comparative inducement.
Right. Yeah. So do you think the conversation will shift from the provision of private benefits to a small limited part of the electorate to public goods like infrastructure, better law and order, those kind of things?
I think it is already shifted. It is shifting. It is a work in progress. I'm not saying it's a done thing, but all of these things, I think, take it to the next step.
Right.
And it is in our interest as a nation that is what the conversation should be about.
Right.
Okay. Excuse me, sir.
Yeah.
Professor Srinath Rao has joined us. He's the national executive member of the BJP. I think he has some thoughts on the idea of one nation, one election. I would like to invite the professor.
Yeah.
Professor, You could
Welcome,
just unmute.
Srinath ji. Have you put him on?
Yes, he's on, sir. He's on.
Yeah.
Namaste.
Ah, okay. Namaste. Is he on video or is he on only audio?
He's on both, sir.
I can see.
Professor.
Huh? Yeah.
Am I audible?
Yes, yes, you are.
Yeah.
Yeah. Respected Raju Chandrasekhar ji, namaste, and respected dignitaries. Anyway, it is one of the very important topics which I have taken for the discussion, One Nation, One Election. As rightly it is pointed out and pitched by Honorable Prime Minister Shri Narendra Modi ji, the nation is in need of this One Nation, One Election, because we are having so many different setups for the elections, and because of that, a lot of time has been taken. And this is definitely is going to affect positively on the development of India, because when the elections are done in under one roof, okay, because we are speaking about one nation and so many other different policies. So why can't we have one election for one nation? Because when we consider the geography of India and also the huge population of India, so definitely when we carry out the One Nation, One Election, definitely it will help, because there are so many different dimensions are there, whether it is economic or whether it is when you consider in terms of the time. And definitely when the elections are done in different places, okay, maybe with a gap of few months or maybe the gap of few weeks, the impact is definitely on the development. And therefore, it is a deep study before implementing and deliberation on one nation and one election. And a single voter list for the Lok Sabha, single voter list for the assembly, including the Jilla Panchayat election, Taluk Panchayat election, and the Panchayat elections. If everything is done at one time, we can save huge resource. We can save the huge resource, and definitely it is going to tap the waste of the resources, which is maybe tangible, or it may be intangible, because there are so many things are there in the elections which are intangible. So this intangible also we can tap it, and whatever the expenditure we can speak in terms of the revenue, so that also can be controlled very well. And definitely more than that, the legislator, the executive and judiciary should work with the better coordination with the national interest, because we are saying it is a one nation, nation first, with the national interest, and should be the basis for this decision. So I say that one nation, one election will definitely going to help out for the Atmanirbhar Bharat, and also for the new India, whatever we are saying in this 2020. So I'm in support of one nation, one election.
Right. Thanks, Srinath ji. That was a great point. And I would now like to invite questions and observations from the audience. So anybody would like to ask Mr. Rajiv Chandrasekhar ji or anybody a question, please raise your hand. We will unmute you and you can start asking. Please, sir, will you just find out who's listening?
You can also pick questions from the chat room, Tushar.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Sir.
I think...
I'll just take the questions from the chat room, please.
Yeah. I think one question which we have already answered is people asking what happens if you have a hung house or a government that falls. I think Rajiv, you answered it, but maybe Rajiv, can you rehash that thing? What is the thing that we are expecting will happen in case of a government that falls pretty quickly or this thing? Can you repeat that answer?
No, I think, look, these are issues that, of course, experts have to work on and develop actual workable constitutional solutions to. But prima facie, for example, if a government, if an election happens to a house and there is no party with a majority, then the house is not dissolved. The sacrosanct point is that the legislature's term remains 1 year.
Hmm.
And it is... the governor can step in and govern. Like I said, maybe the constitution can provide that the three national party or the parties that have been elected will form a group working with the governor. Till such time, some group within the legislature that have been elected by the voters can show a majority. Right. So these are ideas that we have to work on. But that, by the way, Jaggi, this has nothing to do with the fact of simultaneous election.
Right.
This is an issue that confronts us even today.
Yeah, correct.
And so those constitutional provisions. But I just want to take up one quick point on one thing that Professor Srinath mentioned.
Yeah.
It is an important reform that comes with this one nation, one election, which is this issue of harmonizing election roles.
Yeah.
Electoral roles, as you know, is an area where there is total mischief being done at the municipal, city, village, district levels by people if they want to do it. And so there are these multiple electoral rolls that are updated at different times in time. And therefore, you see, for many elections, you'll hear people are not in it, people are in it, people don't get their right to exercise the vote. So having a national electoral roll, now that we have Aadhaar, now that we have all of these other ways of ensuring identity, is also a very important reform that comes attached as a benefit that comes attached with this one nation, one election.
Right.
I think we have a question from Mr. Surendra Srivastava. Yes, sir, please go ahead.
I have one question and a couple of suggestions. One question is that I have filed a PIL in Supreme Court for one national poll to be managed by the post offices across the country. But somehow I find that the government, our own government, BJP government and the ECI is opposing all that. So I'm little foxed that when we talk about one nation, one poll, I think this is the beginning, the voter roll is the beginning of that.
Yeah, no, I don't know. I'm sorry, but I don't know the background of your PIL, so I can't comment on it. But it is the one nation, one electoral roll call has been made by the Prime Minister many months ago. That this is a necessary reform, and it is not a necessary reform. Like I said, the beneficiaries are not political parties. The beneficiaries are all of those 800 million, 80 crore, 90 crore voters who want to make sure that they find their name in the electoral roll without having to worry about it 2 days before the election. So that is a reform that is clearly on the top of the Prime Minister's mind.
Maybe right hand doesn't know the left hand. So I leave that later on, later on discussion. I have one suggestion, Rajiv. You said that, we need a fixed term for the legislature, irrespective of who forms the government. I don't think we have studied the subject. I don't think any constitutional changes are required. One small change is required that where the no confidence motion comes in, along with it should be, there should be also a confidence motion. So both the motions should be taken up at the same time. Yes. Then only it can go through, otherwise it can't go through. That is one aspect. Yes. Second option would be, Rajiv, I would like you to throw some idea to you. I think you can take it up. Another way could be to help and satisfy the regional forces is to give them an opportunity to have directly elected chief minister in the states. So I think that could solve some other problems also, apart from their worry about losing the power.
So my answer is, I don't think this reform is to help a regional party or help any particular. It is to help the voter of India, the citizen of India. And with most things that the Prime Minister thinks through in terms of reforms, whether they're electoral, whether they're governance, whether they're economic, the individual is at the center of it. So this is not an issue to say ki, if you are a regional party, aapke liye ye kar denge. That's not about this. This is about a process. If it happens once in 5 years, it has two very significant dividends. One dividend is the economic dividend from it. And the second is the whole issue of political dividend, that we have legislators who start believing in and understanding that the voters are holding them accountable for 5 years in service. They want work by legislators. And I think those are the two fundamental points around which this proposition works for people.
Right.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much for the answer.
I think Surendra wanted to say something.
Yes, I'm just unmuting.
Surendra Srivastava.
Oh. I'm coming to Sukesh Chandra Sharma. He has a question.
Okay.
He would have to unmute himself.
Okay. Rajiv, only one thing. I'll not take much time because there are other audiences and I think they should get enough time also. See, directly elected chief minister also brings a lot of political accountability in the state. I leave that thought with you. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Kesh, your question, please.
Namaskar, sir. Sir, my question is that what is the mood of media about holding one election, one nation? Whether they are benefiting from it or they are having their own economic agenda in it?
I think, Jaggi, I don't know if you should answer that or...
No, see, both you and me are somewhere in the media. So basically what he is asking is whether media has a vested interest in multiple elections, because then they'll have not just more news, but probably more advertising opportunities.
There are
many people who have vested interest in continuing the status quo. There is media, there is the people who print the banners, the people who, businessmen, real estate, builders. That is, we are not really focused on who benefits from the status quo. We are focused on who benefits from having this kind of harmonized election, which is the actual voter.
Which is a citizen,
The focus should be, and that is where the focus of Prime Minister Modi is.
That's correct. Other thing, don't you think we need some kind of wider participation? I mean, in the recent US election, they had these mail-in ballots. Shouldn't we have some kind of digitally authenticated remote voting also, so that we get more than the usual 50-60% voting? If only 50-60% people are voting, basically we are electing governments on the basis of very narrow participation.
No, I agree. I think a lot of it is also, I have done some studies, for example, in Bengaluru, in the municipal elections, and it is one of the most frustrating things for me that I put in so much of effort as an MP and you will end up having 40% turnout. Yeah. And before that election, huffing and puffing by the election and the roads. And the reason for that is not that apathy alone. The conventional wisdom is that people are apathetic towards election. That is not true. The electoral roll issue that Professor Srinath mentioned is a fundamental reform, Jaggi. And that comes from taking a decision that we want one nation, one election, and there's one roll. The moment you have one roll, and that is digitally backed and digitally enabled, all kinds of other innovation that makes elections and voting better and easier is possible.
Right.
Yeah. I think we have one question from Ms. Meenakshi Karnath. We'll also take that.
Please unmute her.
Yes, I have.
Meenakshi Karnath,
Hi. Sir, can you hear me?
Yes, I can.
Yes, we can.
My only, you very rightly mentioned that like how we are responsible to coming out and voting, our leaders are also responsible towards us, towards in maintaining a duty as such. But with my thing here is when one nation, one one vote comes up, as we see, at least I can talk of Bangalore maybe, it's a little tough to catch hold of our local leaders. What happens in such scenarios where we need to reach out to them? How accountable would that become? Where is the accountability, sir? Measures of accountability. We should have some measures of accountability within the government, maybe.
No, Meenakshi ji, I think we have to be careful that we don't think that we are going to solve everything with one move. The political reforms and governance reforms and economic reforms are wide, large baskets with multiple issues. Your point is about you should have more and more responsive elected representatives, people who are more accessible, more available, which is a separate issue. And I'm not disputing that. I agree with you. But I think as electorate gets more and more aware of who's more responsive, who's more accessible and approachable, they will elect those people. That is a separate issue from what I'm discussing today. What me and Jaggi are discussing along with Professor Srinath and everybody else is this issue that we should not have so many elections in a period of 5 years.
In a period of time.
That it really makes it difficult for you as an electorate and me as an electorate to decide who's actually a performing legislator and who's not. If you don't give a 5 year period to a legislator and you don't have a report card at the end of that, instead you have every 1 year or every 2 years an election, you are not able to get that report card. So I think I talked about political dividend before you joined the call. I don't know if you were there before. Those are two things, the intangibles, as Professor Srinath said, I call it political dividend. These are things that will slowly and systematically improve the performance of the political system.
Thank you. Thank you, Meenakshiji, for your question.
Thank you, sir.
We have one question from Mr. Anil N. I'll unmute him. Let's take one question.
Yeah. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. This one nation, one election sounds promising. But how does it compare with election systems in other democracies, like one in the US, the electoral college system, or any other electoral system in the other democracies like UK and other countries? How does it compare? Has any kind of study been made, and anybody, can you throw some light on that?
Jagi, should I answer that? Or?
Yeah, sure. Please do. Please.
Anil, I think, it's a good question, but actually it's a question that says, can you compare an apple and an orange? Because the US system, as you correctly said, it's electoral college. It's an electoral college that's electing a president. It's a president with significant executive authority. And so it does not matter whether the states have their elections along with the presidential elections, because it is really a democratic country, a federal country in that sense. So that is not a good election to compare ourselves to. So the next best thing is to compare ourselves with the parliamentary system democracies like UK and other countries. So the one nation, one election compares favorably. This concept, the idea, compares favorably to what the systems are in, let's say, Germany, in some part in, to some part in the UK, where there is a sense amongst voters that you send legislators for a certain period to the legislature, number one, and that there is a certain stability to the legislature, that a no confidence is not possible unless there is an alternate formation that is also put on the table at the same time. So I think it is good for generally, regardless of the fact that whether there is a comparable apple to apple system anywhere in the country, even if you look in for ourselves and say we need to have a better system, we will come to this conclusion that this is the better system.
If I may add one point, actually the US electoral system sucks, because each state, each county has a different way of counting votes, and each guy has to authorize an election result. And I mean, this is why an election that was held on November 3 does not get finally settled till the end of December almost. And you almost have counties and states and all deciding their final vote long after the election is over. So there is nothing to learn from that system, even though it's a robust democracy, but their federalism is federalism gone bonkers on the electoral side.
That's right.
I think Professor Srinath also has a point to make here.
Yeah, sorry. Yeah. Srinathji?
Namaste. I just want to mention one thing that Rajiv Chandrasekharji sir has mentioned. We cannot compare an apple with an orange, because India is something different from other countries. And in India, we are having almost 2,500 plus the political parties, and 8 national political parties, and 52 state parties, probably, and more than 2,500 unorganized parties. The most thing is that we have to create the nationalism, and we have to point out, or we have to pitch by saying that the amount which is spent by the government to carry out the election is something huge. If we keep on planning about the elections, then all the government officials, we can say the machinery, 1 month they will be busy with the elections. Because now I'm seeing here in the Gram Panchayat election, if I go to a village accountant office, he will say that, sir, I'm busy with the election duty, please come after 2 weeks. Then again, one more election will come. So if we utilize all these government officials for this particular what you can call it as the election process, then in a year I can say that at least almost 2 months of the working duration will be they will spend on the election only. So think about in a 5 years of duration, how much they will spend. So almost we can say 10 months. 10 months is nothing but almost 1 year. So we are paying the tax to the government and government is paying the salary. And why the salary has to be wasted on carrying out the elections again and again and again and by making use of the government officials again. And look at the some of the states, I don't want to mention the name, some of the states where the hangama is more during the elections actually. And so if we conduct one election throughout the nation, so then the amount which is spent on the security purposes and also whether it may be the entire electoral process, everything can be reduced and whatever the money will be saved, no? So that can be beautifully utilized for so many other benefits for throughout the country. So that is my humble request that we have to go for one nation and one election, because it is not my wish, it is not the wish of any one political party, it should be the wish of each and every Indian who is always thinking about, yes, this India is my country and I don't want to waste the resources which is being collected by.
Yeah. Thank you, Srinath. I think we have time for one last question before we wind up. Okay. Does anybody have one last question?
Yeah, I'm unmuting Vijay Prasad ji. He has.
Yeah, you get the last question, sir.
That is what I want to conclude.
Hi, Rajiv. Hi, Rajiv. This is Vijay Prasad, the BJP spokesperson. And I am also one of the person who advocate one nation, one election as early as possible. Couple of things, okay? How prepared are we and when is the earliest thing that we can introduce this one nation, one election? And the one comment that I want to make is as a party man and as a taxpayer, okay, I am highly cognizant of the resources that we are going to use. And we are going to save also. And imagine the amount of stress we are going to reduce on the paramilitary forces who comes and manages the each and every elections every 2 years or every 3 years. And how are we prepared to bring this one nation, one election at the earliest?
No, I think, look, I can't claim to speak for the government, Vijay. I think, I have tremendous confidence in that the day the people speak and say, we want to do this, we want this done, the government will swing into action and the existing infrastructure that we have can handle simultaneous elections at each booth. So, you know, it's a question of doing more EVMs or creating additional capacity. So that is the easy part. To execute one nation, one election, in my opinion, is not the difficult part. The difficult part or the challenging part today is to make sure that every Indian is aware, wants this, and the process of creating political support for the constitutional amendments that are required go through because the people of India want this. And then the execution part is absolutely, in my opinion, not an issue at all. This Prime Minister and his government has the execution capacity that is not like very many other governments before him. So that is not, I'm not concerned about that. Jaggi, I will just end with one small data point, to bolster the point that was made earlier. Just think of this, just think of what I'm just saying. We are a $2.4 trillion economy on our way to becoming a $5 trillion economy. A $2.4 trillion economy or $2.7 trillion economy means our monthly GDP is 20 lakh crores. Now, 15 years ago, if 1 month of inactivity in a state or 2 months the country was shut down, the loss would have been insignificant. Today, the stakes are, we are playing in the big league. We are out of five top economies in the world. 15 days of wasted time, 15 days of economic impairment, 1 month of economic impairment means numbers of lakhs of crores. Now, for example, if one part of the country is shut down for 1 month, the loss to the economy will not be less than 4 to 5 lakh crores. Now, if I say to an average voter today, 4 to 5 lakh crores saved means so many roads, so many hospitals, so many schools, so many employment opportunities, so much investment, then the actual mathematics of one nation, one poll, the dividends that come from one nation, one poll become obvious. And that is what actually this narrative should be. It is not a moral argument. It is not a convenience argument. It is a actual economic argument, economic dividend, and a political dividend to the people of India. So the we must all support this Prime Minister's call. And my own, the idea of engaging with you, Jaggi, and thank you for the time, was really to create more and more of a consensus amongst the most important stakeholders of this, which is the people, each individual citizen.
Absolutely. That's a great note to end on. That is, once the numbers actually tell you why this makes a hell of a lot of sense, regardless of what one political leader or another political leader says, this is about improving governance. It's about improving economic efficiency. It's about reforming the state of how we are governed. And the voter gets to say and give people time to deliver on their promises, which they make to the voter. So that is what it is. Right now, the voter elects, but the legislator or the government has no chance to deliver on anything, because before he's elected, he's into the next election. So that simply cannot work. So thank you, Rajiv, for giving us the time. Thank you, Professor Srinathji, for the time. Thank you, all of you, for attending this interesting discussion. I hope we have more such conversations. Swarajya certainly will back this initiative quite a bit. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.